I originally titled this Star Wars, The Kingdom Strikes Back, but I believe that it is just a timely message with what the world knows as Halloween coming up, that it is a time to talk about spiritual warfare. And my job today is to be a recruiter, and I want to recruit you to be a mighty warrior in the kingdom of God, to be able to be a rescuer and not a victim in the kingdom of God. And so I want to challenge you today in the area of spiritual warfare. And a great introduction that was, because you say, well, first of all, I'm so messed up, I couldn't possibly get out there and do anything for anybody else. And he says, you're okay. The breaches in your wall are already filled by Jesus Christ. Quit being so inwardly focused and become outwardly focused and be then look around at the weapons of your warfare and pick them up and be ready to do battle for the kingdom of God. And if you do, you will be a fulfilled life. You will have a fulfilled life. Now, maybe I'm only talking to men today because we kind of get hoorah about stuff like this. We like watching movies. We like seeing about things about overcoming, about challenges, about beating the odds. But I guarantee you this, there's probably many more spiritual women in here that are better intercessors and better able to do spiritual warfare than many of us men ever thought about being. So I challenge all of us to join up and be part of that battle. And so this morning, yeah, hoorah, thank you, April. This morning, I want to just start with James chapter 4, verses 1 through 4. As we contemplate spiritual warfare, we need to, first of all, if you're going to be a good soldier of Jesus Christ, we need to be able to recognize the enemy. We need to recognize the enemy. First of all, it is the world. The world, the flesh, and the devil is a common saying among Christians. It's so common, I thought it's actually in the Bible, that exact phrasing. But it's the world, the flesh, and the devil are the enemies of the faith. And it starts out here in James 4:1. It says, where do wars and fights come from among you? Do they not come from your desires for pleasure that war in your members? You lust and you do not have. You murder and you covet and you cannot obtain. You fight and war, yet you do not have because you do not ask. That you ask and you do not receive, because you ask amiss, that you may spend it on your pleasures. Adulterers and adulteresses, do you not know that friendship with the world is enemy with God? And whoever therefore wants to be a friend of the world makes himself an enemy of God. The world's system seeks only selfish indulgence. And so I would call us to be able to step away from pleasure for just a little while, to be able to say, I want to do that which is hard. I want to do that which is hard because it's hard, not because it is easy. I want to go out and do something worthwhile, even though it's hard. And I'm willing to put up with a lack of selfish pleasure for a while so that I can do something greater than myself. A worldly Christian is a traitor to his Lord. And then secondly, recognizing the enemy, not only is it the world, but it's also the flesh. And in 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 1 through 4, it says, therefore, since Christ suffered for us in the flesh, arm yourselves also with the same mind. For he who has suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin, that he should no longer live the rest of his life, the rest of his time in the flesh, for the lusts of men, but for the will of God. We have spent enough of our past lifetime in doing the will of the Gentiles when we walked in lewdness and lusts and drunkenness and revelries, drinking parties, and abominable idolatries. In regard to these, they think it strange that you do not run with them in the same flood of dissipation, speaking evil of you. He says, we spent enough time in the world. We spent enough time doing what we wanted to do. I heard a testimony from a platform just this week of someone saying, you know, boy, back in the day, I did this and this and this. You know, I can't even talk about that, the things I used to do. Yeah, let's not. Let's not talk about the things we used to do, because it's a new day. It's a new time to talk about what we're going to do for the kingdom of God. We spent enough time in the world. We spent enough time on our own pleasures. But right now he says that the flesh in its nature is becoming the enemy of your spirit. And it's time to lay that down and do the things of the Spirit. The world thinks that we've changed, that we are strange, but we've chosen a better path. So the world, the flesh, and then the devil, recognizing the enemy, the devil. 1 Peter chapter 5, verses 8 and 9 says, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, walks about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. And what does he say to do about him? Run from him, right? That isn't what it says. It says what? Resist him. Resist him steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same sufferings are experienced by your brotherhood in the world. They say there is no greater brotherhood than those who have fought together in combat. And there's something about this phrase that just really gets me. It says, resist him steadfast in the faith. And the thought crossed my mind of somebody who's in the, I was in the Air Force, so I can't say I ever did anything like this, but this army mentality where you says steadfast, resist steadfast. I just imagine this guy who's in a machine gun trench, and he's got cover on his backside, and he's placed himself in a way that nothing can get at him from behind, and all he can see is the enemy, and he is safely nested in his little spot, and he's got a 50 caliber machine gun. He's got all the ammunition that he has been able to gather up and store from those who are not willing to stand by, and he has entrenched himself in a spot and says, I am not giving up this ground. I am here steadfast. I am resisting the devil. I'm not shooting over my shoulder and running. I have entrenched myself with a 50 cal and I'm going to take the devil out. I am resisting the devil steadfastly in the faith, knowing that my brothers are doing the same thing on their watch. Knowing that I am not going to be the one who cuts and runs. Knowing that I am not going to be the one who is the victim. I am not going to be the one who wimps out. Knowing that there are others around the world and in my own church who are facing their own battles, and I will stand with them shoulder to shoulder, back to back, all of us looking out at the enemy and standing firm, steadfast in my faith. The world, the flesh, and the devil. James 4:7 says, therefore, submit to God, resist the devil. That's the second time he says that. 1 Peter 5 said, resist him. And then James says, therefore, submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. He will flee from you. Wouldn't it be nice for that arrangement for a while? Anybody but get tired of getting your butt kicked by the devil? Anybody tired of not living in victory? Anybody tired of not being able to overcome? You feel like the devil's out to get you, and if you start standing up and wanting to be in spiritual warfare, I'm afraid I'm going to make myself a target and get shot some more. That isn't how it works. He says, when you stand up and you resist the devil, you receive power. You receive a power, an anointing, and a covering that allows you to overcome the most awesome creature that has ever been created by God. And that is the devil. Now, I didn't just give him credit. What I said is that he was a created being, and he stands as the probably one of the three original archangels over creation. And he was perhaps even the highest of the three. And when Michael, the archangel, went to go and oppose him, it said he dared not bring a railing accusation against him. But I'll show you a little bit later in the scriptures here that whenever you are a man of God, you can. You can stand up against the devil. You can resist him steadfastly. And he will not just leave you alone. He will flee from you. I think that's exciting. I'm ready for that. I need some of that. Recognize the enemy, the world, the flesh, and the devil. And also the forces of evil. The Bible says in Ephesians 6:12, it says, for we do not wrestle against flesh and blood. That's people. They're not our enemy. What if they're in ISIS? The people are not our enemy. But if they take up arms with the devil against that which is righteous, then we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. And just briefly, if you're looking at those things, we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities. Now that's regional rulers, those demonic forces who are not the rank and file demons, but those that are higher in forces that are over all regions. And I believe there's one over North America, certainly over the United States. There's probably one over Florida. There's probably one over Broward County. There are regional devils that have larger power, who have influence in this world, and they are our enemy, and we are able to identify them, call them out by name, and oppose them. I plan to do some of that in the message or during the prayer meeting tonight. If you'd like to come and do some battle, I'd like to be able to name some forces, especially as we reach this season of Halloween, and be able to come against the forces of evil that want to do the will of Satan. We come against principalities and against powers and against the rulers of the darkness of this age. Maybe these are the local demonic rulers, those who are under the principalities. They're still rulers over areas. There may be a ruler over this region, a ruler over Titusville, a ruler over that's been assigned over this church. There have been people who've had visions of a demonic force eating away at our church here. Now, while that may have been just a vision and not a reality, there is a reality that there is a spiritual warfare of demons that wants to eat your lunch, that wants to destroy your life, that wants to divide the body of Christ, wants to set us at odds with one another, and we need to come against them and him, and we have authority to do that in Jesus' name. And then he says of the rulers of the darkness of this age against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. Hosts means a whole bunch of them. It's the rank and file demons, the ones that are assigned to you personally, the ones that wants to go in and just harass at a lower level. It's just your bread and butter, get mad in traffic kind of demonic forces that are assigned in the masses. And those are the lower ranking ones. And we have authority even certainly over those as well. And so he says, these are the ones who come against us, and these are the rank and file, these invisible forces of evil are our enemy, and we are able to overcome them by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony, the word says. And so we've talked about knowing our enemy. Secondly, I want to talk about our weapons of our conquest. What are the weapons of our conquest? First of all, faith. Imagine that. Faith. Faith. The Bible says in 1 John chapter 5 and verse 4, whatever is born of God overcomes the world. And this is the victory that has overcome the world, even our faith. Faith is not an aid to victory. Faith is our victory. Faith is the victory that overcomes the world. If you're going to overcome the world, you got to have faith. And how do you get faith? By reading His Word and hearing His Word. Be exposed to His Word. His Word builds faith in you. And the more faith you have, the more able you are to overcome the enemy. If you are being beaten down and run roughshod over by the enemy, then you need to increase your faith. You might say, Lord, I need a break. Would you get these people off, these demons off my back? But the truth is, you need to be stronger. You need to walk in faith. And when you have that faith, you can oppose the devil and you can tell him to get away from you. You can oppose the devil, but you have to believe it's going to happen. You have to believe it's going to happen. If a demonic force comes up and begins to influence you and get into your space and start to bother you, and you don't believe that you can come against him, then he's got permission from you to continue to harass you. Why? Because you're not walking in faith. But when in faith you believe, then you will resist him, as the word says, and then he will flee from you. So if you're tired of being harassed, grow in your faith. Read the Word. Believe that you are more than a conqueror. Believe that when you resist the devil, he must flee from you, and stop believing the lie. His only effective tool against you is lying. And the lie is, you can't do it. Others can, but you can't. The lie is that God wants to bless everybody, but not you. Or God wants to bless you like everybody else, but not now. There's always a but in there. Satan's a big but. Go with that notion and know that every time we do not believe what the Word of God says for us, then we give permission for the devil to continue to harass and have power over us and in our and influence us. And the only way we're going to overcome is with our faith. The Scripture says in James chapter 1, verses 6 and 7, but let him ask in faith, with no doubting. For he who doubts is like the wave of the sea, driven by the wind and tossed. For let not that man suppose that he will receive anything of the Lord. So be careful that you don't doubt the Lord. Be strong in faith. And if you say, well, what if my faith is weak? And what if it says if I doubt at all, then I'm like a wave of the sea. I'm not going to receive anything of the Lord. I remember a man who was desperate for his child to be healed, and he said to Jesus, would you heal my child? And Jesus said to him, do you believe? And his answer was, Lord, I believe. Help thou my unbelief. We can do that as well. God gives us all the measure of faith. But whenever faith is weak, grace can overcome as well. And we can say, Lord, I have the measure of faith. I have that mustard seed faith that may be small, but I'm going to lay what faith I have on the line. And I'm going to believe your word, and I'm going to claim it by your word, and I'm going to overcome. I'm going to plant that seed of faith, and I'm going to depend on you to give me the rest of the faith I need or the grace I need. Help thou my unbelief. God will answer that prayer and give you what you need. But we've got to believe it. We've got to act on our faith and believe what we have. And then secondly, one of our warfare tools is the Word of God and prayer. The Word of God and prayer. And the Scripture says in Ephesians 6, 17 and 18, it says, and take the helmet of salvation, the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, being watchful to this end with all perseverance and supplication for all the saints. So what he wants you to do is pray, and he wants you to use the Scriptures. And when you pray the Scriptures, then you are mighty and powerful. The Word of God is a weapon. It is called the sword of the Spirit for a reason. Everything in the book of Ephesians 6 there in the armor talked is a defensive thing except for the Word of God. It is the offensive weapon. And he wants you to be able to go on the offense with that Word of God. And when you memorize the Word of God and when you speak the Word of God, then you are using it as a weapon, not on each other, but on the enemy. And so when you pray, you should pray the Scriptures. And what if you don't know the Scriptures? Then it's time to read the Scriptures and get them in you enough to where you begin to memorize them. And if you find a key verse that has a promise in it that has to do with what you're praying about, then you open your Bible, put your finger on that verse, and pray that verse. And say, Lord, in the name, it says, in this verse that I'm reading right here, I'm claiming this verse in Jesus' name, and I'm speaking that no weapon formed against me shall prosper. All those who rise up against me shall fall. If I lack, Lord, that you have all sufficiency in all things, Lord, if there's anything I need, by your stripes I'm healed. Whatever the need is, you can pray that Scripture and have power in Jesus' name, the sword of the Spirit and the shield of faith to be able to overcome in the day. And so he says, the Word of God and prayer. Another scripture, Hebrews 4:12 says, for the Word of God is living and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of soul and spirit, of joints and marrow, and is the discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. The Word of God is an offensive weapon, and the Bible says, talking about faith, faith is the victory that overcomes the world, but it's still a defensive weapon. It's that which we hide behind to keep from being destroyed, to keep from being overcome. But if you're tired of just holding ground, if you're tired of just holding the fort, and you're ready to go have some victory, then sharpen your skills in the Word of God. And begin to pray the Word of God, and you will overcome. Sharper and powerful. Sharp and powerful is the Word of God. Sharp and powerful. James 5:16 says, confess your trespasses one to another and pray for one another that you may be healed. The effective fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. Prayer avails much. Prayer avails much. If you have a problem you cannot overcome, when you surrender and say, I can't do anything about this, God, I'm just going to pray about it. It's time to shut up about it and pray. And when you shut up about it and pray, God begins to do great things. He opens the doors of provision. He begins to work behind the scenes in ways that are amazing. I could give testimony after testimony about how God begins to break through when we pray. Why don't we pray? Because we're still trying to do it ourselves. We're still trying to accomplish His will through our own means, through our own intelligence, through our own jobs, through our own influence, through our own speakings or through our own money or something. We're so trying to make things work. And God says, if you just pray, the prayer of a righteous man avails much. And so the spiritual warfare tools would be also Word of God and prayer. And also Christ promises. Well, where do we find those? In the Word. So we're right back to the Word again. John chapter 16, verse 33 says, these things have I spoken to you, that in me you may receive, or that you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. Jesus said, I have overcome the world. And so if we get in with Him, He wins. He's the general. We attach our wagon to His star. we take our bodies and we run in behind his tank. We allow him to do the air support. We allow him to do the destruction. We allow him to breach the walls of the enemy. And we run in behind him. And since he has already overcome the world, then we also can overcome the world because of Christ's promises. Psalm chapter 34, verse 19 says, "Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers him out of most all of them." It's not what it says, is it? Many are the afflictions of the righteous. That's horrible. I thought when I got saved, everything was going to go well. I thought when I got saved, everything was going to go, all my problems would be solved. I thought when I got saved and all the issues I was praying about and come crying out to God for would be instantly handled. But he says, many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers him out of them all. Have the faith to believe that in his promise, he says, I will deliver you from every problem you have. Now, you're going to have some problems. But how is he going to get victory? How is he going to get glory if he doesn't empower you to do his work in the earth? How is he going to get glory if you don't get a chance to go out and overcome in his name? Anybody, Lord, I would just really like if you just go ahead and solve the problem for me so I don't have to go through all that spiritual warfare stuff. God doesn't hear a prayer like that. You know why? Because he hears and answers prayers that are according to his word. And his word promises that you're going to have tribulation. But fear not. I've overcome the world. And there is nothing that is going to stop me because the Lord delivers me out of all of those problems. All right. And then number four, I got in the name of Jesus is a mighty tool in your spiritual warfare arsenal. John chapter 14, verses 12 through 14 says, "Most assuredly I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also." And this is Jesus talking. The guy who raised the dead, healed the lepers, opened the eyes of the blind, broke the bread and fed 5,000. This is the guy who's speaking here. And he says, "Most assuredly, I say to you that he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also." It doesn't say you're going to do all of them like it's a mirror of his life. But when you find yourself in a situation that you will be able to overcome supernaturally like he did, if we have faith in him and believe that he will do through us what he says he will do. "He who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also, and greater works than these he will do, because I go to my Father. And whatever you ask in my name, he says, that I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son." And he says, "If you ask anything in my name, I will do it." That's an amazing thought. Anything I ask in Jesus' name, he will do? Really? Can I win the lottery? You have faith to believe it? No. Why is that? Because somewhere deep down inside, you know that's probably not the will of God for you. Now, it might be, and if it is for you, please tithe. That would be awesome. But he says, if you do anything, if you ask anything in my name, I will do that. What does he mean by that? To ask in the name of Jesus is to ask as if Jesus himself were the one doing the asking. I can ask the Lord Jesus to help me overcome problems in my life because he would ask the Father to overcome problems in my life. I can ask for him to be able to provide my finances because he promised that my God shall supply all your need according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. I can ask things of the Father in Jesus' name that are the same things that he would ask for if Jesus were here, and I therefore have confidence that I receive them because my thoughts and his thoughts are in alignment with one another. That's what it means to pray in someone else's name. In the name of Jesus, we pray. In the name of Jesus, we ask means that we're asking as if that person were here doing it for me. And if you know that you're asking for something that he would not be asking for himself, then you're probably not going to get it. That's not a destruction of your faith. That should be a faith builder. Because when you, how do you know what Jesus would ask? How do you know what Jesus would do? It's written in his word. Look at the things he did. Look how he acted. Look how he responded in different situations. If you pray the scriptures, as you're reading the scriptures about what he did, then he will do what you ask him to do if you have faith to believe for it. You believe in his name and you ask by faith, he's going to do it. That's much more powerful than we have time to unfold. And then worship. Worship, what does that have to do with anything? It is a weapon of our warfare to overcome the enemy. Joshua chapter 6, verses 1 through 5 and verse 20. I love the stories of the Old Testament because over and over they tell stories that are about our faith for today. He says, now Jericho was securely shut up. And because of the children of Israel, none without and none came in. And the Lord said to Joshua, see, I have given Jericho into your hand, its king and the mighty men of valor. You shall march around the city, all your men of war, and you shall go around the city once. This you shall do for 6 days. And 7 priests shall bear 7 trumpets of ram's horns before the ark. But on the 7th day, you shall march around the city 7 times, and the priests shall blow the trumpets. Everybody say trumpets. That's a musical instrument. And it shall come to pass when they make a long blast of the ram's horn, and when you hear the sound of the trumpet, that the people shall shout with a great shout. Now, one was the musicians, and the other is the congregation. And together, between the musicians leading the charge and the congregation shouting praise to God, something effective and powerful happens. The wall of the city will fall down flat, and the people shall go up every man straight before him. And so the people shouted when the priests blew the trumpets. And it happened when the people heard the sound of the trumpet, and the people shouted with a great shout, that the wall fell down flat. And the people went up into the city, every man straight before him, and they took the city. There is power in worship. Worship keeps the thought of the Lord before your mind. And when you keep the thoughts of the Lord before your mind, then you are following Him into combat. Now let's talk about a little bit about the methods of our attack. What are the methods of our attack? How can we use our spiritual weapons? What does the Bible teach about ways that we can do spiritual warfare? First of all, we can pull down strongholds. What are strongholds? Simple definition would be stubborn things. Stubborn things are strongholds. I have stubborn spots on my cabinet whenever I'm trying to scrub it off. You know the ones. You know the one that's there? You just wipe and wipe and wipe, and it just stays there. And you rub and rub and rub, and it doesn't come off. And so you rub sideways and then up and down in a circle, and it just stays and endures. Stubborn things that will not go away. We have stubborn things that have attached to our life. We are stains in our life that are strongholds in our life that need to be overcome. And he says that what are we supposed to do to strongholds? We're supposed to pull them down. Well, how? That's the whole idea. They're strong, Lord. They're strongholds. And he's like, well, what do I do, Lord? It's a stronghold. Pull it down. Pull it down. What? For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty in God. Mighty in God for pulling down strongholds. It doesn't say God is mighty to pull down strongholds. That isn't what it says. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty in God for pulling down strongholds. If there's a stronghold of sin in your life, if there's a stronghold of failure in your life, you need to quit praying for God to help you with that and start using the warfare tools that He's already given you. Faith, believing, praying, speaking the word, and pull that stronghold down. It's enough time we've spent with that stronghold in the way. It's enough time that it's just like in your face and won't go away. It's enough time that it's become a stumbling block to you. It's time to wipe it out. And he says the weapons of our warfare are mighty in God, not adequate. Not like, you know, a spoon for a shovel or something. not something that you can pick at and hope that one day you can erode that thing down, or maybe the elements will come and wash it away, or maybe God will flick his finger and knock it down. He says, you have the warfare tools to be able to destroy the strongholds of the enemy. Casting down arguments and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. What kind of argument? The kind of argument that says that you will fail. The kind of argument that says this stronghold will be here forever. The kind of stronghold that says that you are lucky to be saved and you definitely aren't getting out of here with a lot more, without a lot more sinning going on in your life. That is a stronghold, a lie of the enemy that needs to be cast down. That it's casting down that argument of lies and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. God knows what he did for you through the gospel, through his blood, through the sacrifice he did for you. God knows the power you have. But he says there are arguments against God's power in your life. There are arguments and lies that we believe in our lives. And he says the weapons of our warfare are for pulling down the stronghold. Cast, and while you're up there, by the way, you got to climb up on that thing to pull it down. It says you're up on top of that thing, not being crushed by it. You're on top of that thing and you are peeling off, tearing down the stronghold. And while you're up there, you cast down the lies. That implies you're on top. That implies you are in the midst of battle. That implies you have not just walked up to a stronghold and waited for somebody to knock it down for you. It means you went and got a ladder and climbed to the top and started ripping away the stones. And once you've got a brick in your hand, you're like, boom! I am casting down the arguments and the lies that have said I must be under this domination. I will not be defeated. Casting down the strongholds, the arguments, and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing every thought into captivity. I got a pen waiting outside. For every one of my thoughts are going to bring it into captivity. I'm not going to allow them to wander. I'm not going to allow them to stray. I'm not going to allow myself to think how good it was when I was under that bondage of that sin, how good it felt, but I'm going to take those thoughts captive. I'm going to grab hold of them. I'm going to keep those passions of my flesh on a short leash. I'm not going to allow my thoughts to wander. I'm not going to allow my thoughts to look for the easy way out. But I'm bringing those things as part of my warfare. It's, you know what it's like? It's like if you don't keep your thoughts captive, then it's like climbing up that ladder and start ripping down the rocks and somebody just kicks the ladder right out from under you. When you don't keep your thought life in order, then you lose the battle. Keeping every thought in order. Not only the victorious thoughts for victory, but also those thoughts that want to wander, you keep them in captivity. You don't say the things that destroy yourself. You don't say the things that bring you down. Keep them in captivity. So pull down the strongholds. So we talked about methods of attack being pulling down strongholds. Another method is ambush. I like ambush. There was an ambush at Ai. Ai in the Old Testament, they had conquered Jericho, and they're going to defeat Ai. And at Ai, it says, do we have the scripture coming up in Joshua chapter 8, verses 14 and 18 and 19. It's a long story. I wanted to read the whole thing, but there's only time for the meat of it. Now it happened when the king of Ai saw it that the men of the city hurried and rose early and went out against Israel to battle. He and all his people at an appointed place before the plain. But he did, what did it say? But that's it? But he did. Okay, let's go to verse 18. All right. It says, that's not the rest of the verse, yeah. But he did not know that they were lying in wait. He did not know that there was an ambush that was coming, if and when that comes up on the scripture there. He did not know that they had already hidden in the hills. He did not know that whenever they called him out to the appointed place to battle and they go running out the gate to defeat the Israelites, that there was an ambush waiting on the other side. That while they were out there battling, that there was going to be a destruction raining down on their city once they left it. That's called an ambush. And an ambush is what you do when an ambulance drives by and you think, Lord, I pray you would save that person from death. Lord, I pray in Jesus' name that you would let people get saved because of what's going on in that ambulance right now. Or you just drive by and you just see a certain house. You say, Lord, I pray you'd bless that person. They got mowing the grass right there. I pray that he'd be convicted of sin and I pray that he'd be saved. It's called random acts of violence against the kingdom of God. He never knows what you're going to do next. The devil hates you and he's scared of you because, oh my God, he's awake again. What's she going to pray today? I have no idea. Keep her sleepy. Keep her at home because she gets out wandering around. There is no telling what she's going to do. She's going to do random acts of violence against the kingdom of God because of ambush. Ambush. There are more things in the world that we could pray about than we have time to pray for. There are more wrongs in the world than we could possibly try to make right. And so the tendency of people is to give up on them and not do anything. So do what you can do. When God puts it in front of you, handle it. Handle it right then and right now and ambush the kingdom of darkness. Ambush. Also, unified combat when you're outnumbered. Matthew chapter 18, verse 19. Matthew 18, 19 says, again, I say to you, if two of you agree on earth concerning anything they ask, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. There is more power when you agree in prayer. Another scripture for that, Leviticus 26, verse 7 and 8 says, you will chase your enemies, but they will fall by the sword before you. Listen to this. Five of you will chase 100. And 100 of you will put 10,000 to flight. I did the math. Five of you chasing 100 means 5% chases 100%. That's pretty good. That's pretty powerful. He says, but 100 of you will put exponentially more. 10,000 to flight. That's 1%. 1% effort puts a 99% effort against the enemy. The more people agree in prayer, the more powerful we are. So pray together. Pray in agreement. If you have a particular issue you're trying to overcome, then you get a hold of somebody else who has faith and you say, would you pray with me about this issue? That's why we ask for prayer requests in small groups. That's why we say, is there anybody needs anything prayed for? That's why you come to an altar and have someone pray with you. It's because there is power, exponential power, when we pray together in prayer. So those are ambush, unified combat when outnumbered. But here's another one. Personal combat of champions when standing alone. Oh, these are the coolest. They're not going to put the most to flight, maybe because of prayer and agreement together. But how often we find ourselves all by ourselves. Let me grab my Bible. There's a good idea. Let's preach in the Bible today. 1 Samuel chapter 17. I'm not going to read the whole chapter, but I am going to pull excerpts out of all this familiar story, and we're going to close with this. Personal combat of champions. 1 Samuel 17. Now the Philistines gathered their armies together to battle and were gathered at Socah, which belongs to Judah. And they encamped between Socah and Azekiah and wherever they were. And Saul and the men of Israel were gathered together and camped in the valley of Elah and drew up in battle array against the Philistines. The Philistines stood on a mountain on one side, and Israel stood on a mountain on the other, with a valley between them. And a champion went out from the camp of the Philistines named Goliath from Gath, whose height was 6 cubits and a span. That's about 9.5 feet, if you're doing the math. That's a big guy. He had a bronze helmet on his head, and he was armed with a coat of mail, and the weight of his coat was 5,000 shekels of bronze. He had a bronze armor on his legs, bronze javelin between his shoulders. Now the staff of his spear was like a weaver's beam, and his iron spearhead weighed 600 shekels, and a shield bearer went before him. Then he stood and cried out to the armies of Israel and said to them, why have you come out to line up for battle? Am I not a Philistine, and you are servants of Saul? Choose a man for yourselves, and let him come down here to me. If he is able to fight with me and kill me, then we will be your servants. But if I prevail against him and kill him, then you shall be our servants and serve us. And the Philistine said, I defy the armies of Israel this day. give me a man that we may fight together. When Saul and all Israel heard these things, words of the Philistines, they were dismayed and greatly afraid. Now David, on the other hand, and I'm going to drop down to verse 16, says, and David heard about, he was gathered at home and doing his sheep handling and tending and so forth. Verse 16 says, the Philistine drew near and presented himself 40 days, morning and evening. 40 days, the same challenge. 40 days looking for a champion. 40 days looking for someone not to cower in fear before this one who defied Almighty God. Verse 24, it says, and all the men of Israel, when they saw the man, fled from him and were dreadfully afraid. So the men of Israel, verse 25, said, have you seen this man who has come up? Surely he has come up to defy Israel. It shall be that the man who kills him, the king will enrich with great riches, will give him his daughter and give him his father's house, exemption from taxes in Israel. Woohoo, I'm in. Then David spoke to the men who stood by, saying, what shall be done for the man who kills this Philistine and takes away his reproach from Israel? For who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he should defy the armies of the living God? The people answered him in his manner, saying, so it shall be done for the man. And he skips down to verse 29. David also said, what have I done now? Is there not a cause? Skipping up to verse 39. David fastened his sword to his armor and tried to walk, for he had not tested them. And David said to Saul, I cannot walk with these, for I have not tested them. So David took them off and put on his spiritual armor. Then he took a staff in his hand and he chose for himself five smooth stones from the brook. Why five? Because Goliath had four brothers. And he put them in a shepherd's bag in a pouch which he had, and a sling was in his hand, and he drew near to the Philistine. And a Philistine came and began drawing near to David. And the man who bore the shield went before him. And when the Philistine looked about and saw David, he disdained him, for he was only a youth, ruddy and good looking. So who's the youth and good looking? Everybody loves a hero. Where was I? Verse what? 43. And So the Philistine said to David, am I a dog that you came at me with sticks? And the Philistine cursed David by his gods. And the Philistine said to David, come to me, come here. Come here, and I will give your flesh to the birds of the air and the beasts of the field. So he started the trash talk. Well, he'd been trash talking for 40 days. He just started his trash talk with David. You know, the devil screams at you insults. The devil screams and hurls insults at you and trash talks you. And you can believe it or you can overcome it. David starts a little trash talk of his own. And David said to the Philistine, you come to me with a sword and a spear and with a javelin, but this ain't trash. I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. So you come against evil that comes against you when you're being a solo champion, when no one's standing with you, when no one's there to intercede in prayer with you, when there's no prayer partners and it's in the darkness in the middle of the night and the devil is screaming insults at you that you will fail, you will die, you will not overcome this battle, screaming insults at you and you say, I will not be overcome. You come to me with insults. You come to me with the world's thinking. I come against you with the Word of God. Verse 46, this day, and he starts the trash talk, the Lord will deliver you into my hand, and I will strike you and take your head from you. And this day I will give the carcasses of the camp of the Philistines to the birds of the air and the wild beasts of the earth, that all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel. Remember the deal? If I lose, you guys serve us. And if you lose, then you guys serve us. Or the other way around, they would serve each other. David ups the ante. He says, we're taking no prisoners. Not only are we going to win, we're going to destroy all of you. You dare defy us? You want to put us in slavery? You want to send out your dog Philistine out here and he wants to defy the armies of Israel? He says, no, I'm up in the ante. Not only am I coming out to be the champion against your champion, I'm going to take him down by God's power and there will be no mercy. So you better switch sides now. Then all the assembly shall know that the Lord does not save with a sword or spear, for the battle is the Lord's, and He will give you it to our hands. And so it was, when the Philistine arose and came near to meet with David, that David hurried, not away. David hurried and ran toward the army to meet the Philistine. That's faith. That's not trash talking and shaking. That's not trash talking hoping they back down. That's trash talk and running toward the enemy like you mean business and you have every intention of destroying them. He ran toward the enemy to meet the Philistine. Then David put his hand in his bag and he took out a stone and he slung it and he struck the Philistine in the forehead so that the stone sunk into his forehead. First guided missile. And he fell on his face to the earth. But he wasn't dead yet. He just had a rock in his head. So David prevailed over the Philistine, do you think? With a sling and a stone, and struck the Philistine and killed him, but there was no sword in the hand of David. Therefore David ran over, stood over the Philistine, took his sword, and drew it out of its sheath and killed him and cut off his head with it. And then when the Philistines saw that their champion was dead, they fled. Because when you resist the devil, he will flee from you. Now the men of Israel and Judah suddenly got their courage back and arose. And so will your friends, neighbors, and other church people when you dare stand solo against the works of evil. You will not be defeated, not be overcome, but instead you will inspire others to follow in your stead and have the courage that you had to overcome. So the men of Israel stood and shouted and pursued the Philistines as far as the entrance of the valley to the gates of Ekron. And the wounded of the Philistines fell along the road to Shaharim, as far as Gath and Ekron, which were cities of the Philistines. Listen to this. And the children of Israel returned from chasing the Philistines, and they plundered their tents. And David took the head of the Philistine and brought it to Jerusalem, but he put his armor in his tent. That's called trophy taking. You guys go plunder the tents. I got all the prize I need. I got the head of my enemy. There was no CNN. There were no newspapers to record it. There were no photography. So he brought the head of the enemy to his capital, Jerusalem, and to his king. Say, we are the victors. We are the victors. Let everyone see the head of the enemy and see that we are victors in Jesus' name. And through His power, through His word, and in His name, and under the blood, we can overcome even Goliath. And we will not just put them in subjugation, we will utterly defeat them. And you know what he did with the armor? He didn't put the head in his tent. That's gross. It would rot. But he kept the armor. He was too small even for Saul's armor, let alone Goliath's. But he kept his armor in his tent. Why? As a reminder of what God had done that day. God will continue to work through us when we have faith. I am tired. I am sick and tired of Christians being overcome by something as weak as the lies of the enemy. You are powerful. Through faith in Jesus Christ, you can overcome all strongholds. it's been recorded in Scripture that when the children of Israel overcame their enemies, there was about four different things that happened to them. First of all, they were utterly destroyed in some cases. Strongholds of the enemy, utterly destroyed. Other times, they made them servants. This is what we do with our fleshly nature. We don't kill our flesh. Fleshly nature is our enemy, so we become masters of it. Then we make them servants to us. And some were ruled over. They were ruled over. And so we, with binding and loosing, use the authority of Jesus Christ to be able to rule over the things in life that are opposing righteousness and goodness in our nation, in our land, the laws that are unjust. We bind and we loose the strong man, and we use the rulership that he gave us to overcome when there are wrong laws and so forth. And then sometimes they deported them. Sometimes they deported them. It's called casting out demons. That demon wants to keep rearing its ugly head. Some kind of demonic influence in you and your life that will not give up. It hides in a stronghold. When you tear down a stronghold, you cast out the demon. And he can't come back because the stronghold's gone. Sometimes we just need to have the demons cast out. Whatever it is, we need to follow him. I'm way out of time. Aren't you glad I don't do the subject every week? Stand if you will. We're going to get out of here. I would love to have time for an invitation where we stand and we spend time with God saying, I want to be a warrior. I want to be a mighty man of God. I want to have faith so I can move mountains. I'm tired of being defeated by the enemy, and I want to be able to move in strongholds. So we're going to just pray that in our closing prayer, and then I'm going to say the blessing over you, and we're going to be gone. And you're not going to look at your watch, and you're going to forgive me for taking too much time. But I'm not really going to apologize for doing the will of the Lord today. It's been good to be in the house of the Lord, don't you think? Amen. Heavenly Father, I pray in Jesus' name that you would make us warriors for Christ. I pray, Lord, that this would not be just a one-time sermon, Lord, that gets us excited, but we forget the scriptures that we need to know to overcome in combat. I pray, Lord, this would be the beginning of basic training, Lord, whereas we would commit ourselves to service and to discipline of our bodies, Lord, so that we could become champions for Christ. I pray, Lord, that we would believe that the banner under whom we serve is the Lord, and that banner, through that, we will overcome in Jesus' name and overcome every stronghold. I pray that we would believe that we are part of something so great that we will never be defeated. And if we need our allies and our buddies, that we will call on them, and we will strengthen ourselves and our numbers by praying with one another. And I pray, Lord, that when we find ourselves alone with nothing but ourselves to stand against the enemy's lies, Lord, that we would stand in faith and come against and be valiant and strong like David did against Goliath, and that we would declare that we will not go into the dark quietly, but we will overcome in Jesus' name, and all the armies of hell will not overcome us, because we are bought by the blood of the Lamb, and we are children of Almighty God, and we are princes and princesses in the kingdom of God, and we will never die. And we thank you, Lord, for that salvation, that eternal life, and the power and authority you've given us in your name. And I pray that you would help us to go out and destroy strongholds this week in our lives and in those around us in Jesus' name. Amen.